I'm supposed to do is follow instructions as well as I can. And if I don't get it exactly right, understand, age does make a difference in keeping up with things. But anyhow, some of the things that we want to tell you is, start off, all candidates shall be seated facing the audience behind the provided name card that will be up here. Candidates may bring notes, pads, etc., but additional props will not be allowed. There will be a courteous atmosphere throughout the entire forum. Opening statements will be given in alphabetical order. Ushers will be positioned in the aisles and will have index cards and pens. Anyone who would like to submit a question to the panel may ask an usher for a card. Of course, all that's been said before. The screening panel will, of course, you heard him say, will look at the questions that you write down. I don't originate any questions. I don't want to do that. Anyhow, and the timekeeper is the distinguished publisher, Northeast Georgian over here, Alan Neesmith, and he will be, each candidate will be given 1 minute to answer each question, and the timekeeper will notify candidates at the end of the allowed time. Closing statements will be given in reverse order from the opening statements. And of course, you have 1 minute in the closing statements. And that's basically the same rules that we've had all along with these forums. So we were originally scheduled to start with the district attorney from the Mountain Judicial Circuit, but because of another commitment of Senator John Wilkinson, they have agreed to let him go first and make his presentation, and after that, then we will start with the district attorneys. So, Senator Wilkinson, you want to come up? You want to come up here to the podium and stand here? It will be just fine.
Okay, Alan, tell me how much time I have. That's not funny. I do want to say I'll just be brief with my remarks. There are eight counties in this senatorial district, and there are a good many things going on today, but it was very important to me to be here to talk to you face-to-face tonight before I go somewhere else. I am John Wilkinson. I'm the state senator from the 50th Senatorial District. That district is composed of Towns County, Rabun County, Habersham, Stevens, Franklin, and Banks County, all of those counties, and half of Jackson County, and one precinct in Hall County, Gillsville. I've served for just a little over 4 years now. I serve in the Senate as chairman of the Senate Agriculture and Consumer Affairs Committee. I serve as vice chairman of the Education and Youth Committee. I serve on the Appropriations Committee. I chair the Appropriations Subcommittee on Agriculture and serve on the Education Subcommittee. I serve on the Natural Resources Committee, and I serve on the Committee on Assignments in the State Senate. I feel like those are some good assignments, and I don't say that to boast. I just say since I've been there, one thing that I'm real proud of, I've been there for 5 sessions, and I haven't missed a day of work in those 5 sessions. And I've tried to get to work early and work hard on your behalf, and I've requested assignments that I thought could be helpful to Northeast Georgia. I'll give you a couple of examples where I think those committee assignments have been beneficial to my constituents. This past year, well, year before last, as part of the appropriations process, I knew that we needed some expansion in a new building on this campus here where we are. Well, when the governor's budget came out, it didn't have anything in the budget for that construction. And then when the budget came out of the House, there was nothing in the House budget. So in the Senate, I was able to put in $800,000 for planning, because I felt like if we could start planning on a project and have it ready, we would have a better opportunity to have it funded. So this past year, with the help of Representative Rogers and Representative Gasway in the House, We were able to get $12.5 million in the budget for campus expansion here at Clarksville. I think all of us know, if we look at the job statistics, that a lot of the jobs that young people that are in demand these days are not jobs that necessarily require a four-year college degree, but they do require some education past high school, and career and technical education is very important. So I think that was something that'll be helpful to Northeast Georgia. As chairman of the Agriculture Committee and serving on appropriations, I know all of you, I know Farm Bureau is helping with the event tonight, but agriculture has a $74 billion impact on our state. Out of that $74 billion, poultry is $32 billion. We were faced with a threat last year of the avian influenza that could have completely wiped out the poultry industry in our state. Because we've appropriated money for the vet diagnostic labs, for the poultry lab in Hall County, and then at the University of Georgia in Tifton, we were successfully able to meet that challenge up to this point. Now, I realize we may not be completely out of the woods, but I think that's another example of money that we've invested that's helped Northeast Georgia. A lot of times when we hear that the airport in Atlanta is the busiest airport in the world and the port at Savannah is the fourth busiest container port in the United States, we don't think about agriculture related to that, but the biggest export that goes out of Savannah is poultry. And a lot of that poultry comes from Northeast Georgia. So I've tried to work hard on your behalf for the past 4 years. I hope that you'll give me the opportunity to do that for two more years. I'm John Wilkinson. I appreciate the opportunity to be with you tonight, and I would appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Wilkinson. And I might point out the reason we did it that way is because his opponent was not able to be here tonight, so he was the only act in his time on the schedule. So we went ahead and let him go first so he could go on to another forum that's taking place now. Next, we're going to have the district attorney from the Mountain Judicial Circuit, George Christian, and Bruce Russell. Would you gentlemen come to this podium, please? Okay, gentlemen, we'll start, George, with you. First of all, your opening statement.
Thank you very much. My name's George Christian. I'm your district attorney. Let me give you a little bit of background in the short period of time that we have. I'm a Navy veteran, a graduate of the University of Georgia, graduated from law school at Mercer University. Following that, I began my career as a prosecutor in the district attorney's office in Houston County. There, I prosecuted cases for approximately 8 years, murder cases, child molestation cases, and everything in between. Upon leaving the district attorney's office, I was fortunate enough to be able to go to work at the United States Attorney's Office for the Middle District of Georgia. I worked there for over 20 years, and when I left there, I was chief of the criminal division, overseeing the federal prosecutions in 70 counties in the state of Georgia, as well as supervising and mentoring 17 assistant United States attorneys and support staff. I left there 2 weeks later, started working for Brian Rickman, who was then the district attorney here in the Mountain Judicial Circuit. I met Brian through a Secret Service agent and one of his cousins, Al Story. Developed a relationship with the Stories and the Rickmans, and worked for Brian for about 4 years before he was appointed by the governor to the Georgia Court of Appeals. And on February the 16th of this year, I was appointed to be your district attorney. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, George. Notice the red light, gentlemen, comes on. Try to close as near as you can at the when you see that light come on. Okay, Bruce?
Sure. I'm Bruce Russell, Jr., and I respectfully request for your support and your vote to be your next district attorney. I'd like to thank the Habersham Chamber of Commerce and Farm Bureau for putting on this great debate. The open exchange of ideas is the cornerstone of our democracy. I only have just a minute to open, so very quickly, again, I'm Bruce Russell, Jr., and I want to be your district attorney. I was raised in Rabun County, went to Rabun County High School, and graduated in 1993. After college, I joined the United States Navy, spent 6 great years in the Navy. I started out as a military policeman, and then later I went to sea on a destroyer, the USS O'Kane. I was a anti-submarine warfare specialist on the O'Kane. We deployed to the Persian Gulf. Al-Qaeda doesn't have a whole lot of submarines. So since I had law enforcement experience, I was able to lead a security detail on a search and seizure team. We got to board vessels and ships in the Persian Gulf for suspected terrorist activity, smuggling, and piracy. We just called them bad guys. After I received my honorable discharge, went on to Mercer Law School, and then came back here to practice law with my dad. I have all the legal experience necessary to be your district attorney. I'm qualified, dedicated, and committed to the law. I'm experienced, and I am committed to serving as your district attorney with honesty, integrity, and fairness.
Okay, thank you very much, Bruce. Okay, we've got four questions for you gentlemen, and I'm going to ask the first question, and we'll start with you, George, and then Bruce, you pick it up immediately after he gives his answer. And the first question is going to be, if elected, what will be your first priority in office? George.
My first priority will be to replace Maggie Hastings, who is an assistant district attorney in Rayburn County. She went to work for Brian in the Georgia Court of Appeals as a staff attorney. I've already met with the three different offices in a day-long meeting and outlined my goals and desires for the office. We're going to be, as I told them, professional. We're going to prosecute with integrity. We're going to be open. And we are going to go forward with the office without favor or affection to anybody. And so that's my priority.
Okay. Bruce.
Okay. My first priority will be to review all of the policies and procedures in the district attorney's office. I've been out on the road actually running a bit of a traditional campaign. I've met with a lot of small business owners here in Habersham County, a lot of the citizens. I see a lot of familiar faces out there in the audience tonight. And when I've been out there on the campaign trail, one of the big issues that small business owners have said to me is that we have employees and we have a lot of people that we're trying to employ that are either in the drug court or have issues with drugs. And one of the issues that they tell me is that they can't put in a full 40-hour work week because they're spending so much time in the drug courts. And I plan on having a review of the drug courts and the policy of how we do that with an eye of trying to shift the burden back to the drug courts and keep that burden off of our employers.
Okay. Thank you, Bruce. Next question, we'll start with you, Bruce. And the question is, what are your thoughts on the situation with the city of Demarest? Will you make this case your top priority and strongly encourage the aid of the GBI to resolve this issue?
Well, I think that we have to work very closely with our own agencies here in the circuit and to not try to look outside the circuit in order to try to solve our problems.
Okay. George?
Well, if you'll clarify, are you talking about the missing money?
Yes.
Okay. All right. The GBI has completed an investigation. It's been reviewed by former District Attorney Brian Rickman, and he met with the mayor and council at Demarest about that particular matter. Unless there's new evidence that comes forward, I don't see any reason to open it back up. We're certainly open to looking at something if somebody has additional information. There's been some discussion by the city of Demarest about requesting the FBI to come in and take over the investigation, do a separate investigation. Certainly we would have no objection to that at all. So if there's additional information, we'd be glad to look at it. We'd be glad to look at it, review it again. If the FBI wants to come in and look at it, we respect their ability to investigate and prosecute federally if that's what comes out of the investigation.
Okay. Bruce, what is your biggest concern regarding crime in our district, and what is your plan to improve this situation?
I think that without a doubt, that our biggest problem right now is drug trafficking and the negative effects that the drugs have on our community. I intend to effectively and efficiently use the drug courts in order to attempt to rehabilitate the low-level offenders and try not to send our addicts off to prison and have them come back as repeat offenders and not be good members of our society. From a standpoint of the drug traffickers and the drug dealers, I will aggressively prosecute those individuals and do what we can to send those people off to prison as long as we possibly can.
Okay.
With respect to the drug issue here, it's not unique to the Mountain Judicial Circuit. Drugs are a problem everywhere. There is a two-sided equation. There's a supply and demand. Law enforcement and the district attorney's office can work on the supply side. We can prosecute folks all day long, but as long as there's a demand, we're going to have a lot of job security. I don't like job security in that regard, but the community has to step forward and through schooling, through education, through various programs and address the use of drugs in our community. The Drug Court is a great organization. We utilize that. We had Drug Court graduation last night, and it was fantastic. Y'all, please come to some of our Drug Court graduations. You'll see success stories. Addicts who are getting rid of the addiction, who are going to break the cycle of addiction for their children and grandchildren. Yes, sir.
Do you have a specific plan in regards to managing the DA office in a financially efficient way?
Well, of course, the county commissioners do a good job of that. We have three counties in our circuit, and they're very generous and with our budgets. We're not going to ask for increased size of budgets. We have plenty of money to work with. One of the things that I stress to our folks in the day-long meeting is that we're going to initiate case reviews, something we have not done before. And also performance reviews, and that'll help keep cases moving through the pike, and will make it more efficient. And hopefully, the goal is that cases will not last so long to get from start to finish. So, in terms of the budgets, we work with the county commission commissioners in our three counties very well. Have great relationships. Brian Rickman created a lot of goodwill with the county commissioners, and we're enjoying that. Thank you.
Okay, Rick.
It is a give and take with the county commissioners and the DA's office. I will tell you that I'll initiate a review of the way that we manage cases there. Coming from the private sector, a law firm in itself is a small business, and I have a lot of experience stretching a dollar. To get cases completed and get places done. It's incumbent upon the DA's office, just like any other office in the public trust, to manage those cases effectively and to try to return that value back to the taxpayer. And I look forward to working with the county commissioners in all three counties and trying to figure out exactly how we can either trim from the budget or keep those budgets static and proceed with our caseload in a very inefficient manner.
Okay, gentlemen, is that the final question that you have for us? Okay, we'll now have your closing statement, and I believe, Bruce, you'll go first. Closing statement.
Like I said before, your district attorney, like all public officials, needs to discharge his office with an eye towards fiscal responsibility. Now, we have to rely on our other officers or our other legislators in the executive branch to lower our taxes, but it remains a truth that all the offices in our public trust must exercise some fiscal responsibility, and my office will continue to operate with fiscal responsibility. That being said, we have a duty to protect our citizens. We have to prosecute cases diligently, effectively, and send a clear message that crime doesn't pay in Habersham County. Now, I'm not opposed to alternatives to jail like probation, drug courts, and boot camps. But when it's clear that criminals are using the system in order to avoid punishment, then they have to be removed from society, and that means jail. And I will fight to send those people to jail that need to go there. I have a long family tradition of public service. I want to continue that tradition. And if you trust this office to me, I'm quite certain that I won't let you down. Thank you.
Good, George.
Thank you. Public service is what I've done since day one. I've walked with victims. I've gone to funerals. I've been in homes where the victim's family is crying, where you have all the food on the table that we do it here in the South, you know, when people are hurting. The district attorney has to make very difficult decisions about cases, how to proceed on cases, what cases you can go forward with, some that you can't, even though you know that a defendant more than likely committed the crime. Those are hard decisions that you have to reach back and use your experience and hopefully the wisdom that you've gained over the years of prosecuting folks. And I have the management experience, the leadership experience to lead this office, to prosecute cases and represent the state of Georgia. And I want to continue to be your district attorney, and I need your vote and support, and most of all, your prayers. Thank you.
Okay, we're now back with the Board of Education. By the way, I was told to mention the fact that Robert Barron was unable to attend tonight, but he doesn't have any opposition, so therefore he felt it wasn't necessary for him to be here, I guess. So, but anyhow, but we do have one part of the Board of Education competitive, and that is with Don Corbett and Doug Westmoreland. Don, we'll start with you with your opening statement.
Thank you, and thank you to the Chamber and the Farm Bureau and North Georgia Tech for hosting the event. I'm glad to be here. My name is Don Corbett, married to Cindy Corbett. She's an elementary instructor in the system, and my son John is a rising, he's a senior. He's a graduating senior, and they are not here tonight. They're at a playoff soccer game in Duluth, so go Raiders. We're members of St. Mark Catholic Church. I graduated from the Piedmont College Walker School of Business. I've always worked in the private sector. I'm the only private sector employee currently on the Board of Education. I have a background in construction, real estate, product distribution, and logistics. And I've been serving on the board since 2013. I'm currently the chair. In this time, we've seen much progress. Student achievement, we have the highest graduation rate on record. Financial efficiency, we've balanced revenues and expenses for the last 2 years through conservative spending practices and zero-based budgeting. We've restored a full calendar for next year for the first time since 2008-2009. And safety and security, and our partnership with the Habersham County Sheriff's Office, our schools are safer than ever, and we've actually saved money through that collaboration. With your vote, I'd like to continue the advancements that have been made in our school system for the next 4 years.
Okay, thank you, Don. Next, Doug Westmoreland.
Thank you, Senator Foster, and I really appreciate the Farm Bureau and the Chamber putting this on. This has been really an experience for me, and it's good to see this crowd out here. I didn't expect this many, but I am so glad this many did show. I am Doug Westmoreland. I'll just tell you just real quickly about myself. I had 31 years in education in Habersham County. I taught 28 years as a mathematics teacher at Habersham Central High School. I coached 25 years. I was the head coach of 4 different varsity sports. And I was the assistant principal of Ninth Grade Academy for 2 years. And I was the director and principal of the Alternative School and Success Academy for 3 years. The reason I'm running is because I feel like I've got something to give back to our school system that's been so loyal to me. I want to be loyal back to them. And when these groups, the principals or the administration, the teachers or the coaches, when they come, I can be an advocate for them. And the experience that I have and the relationships that I have developed over the 31 years, I think is going to be very beneficial to bring to the board. And I really appreciate your support. Doug Westmoreland, Board of Education. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Starting with the questions, we'll start with you, Don. Testing standards, teacher accountability are primary dictated at the state and federal levels. The two primary tasks of a local board is passing a balanced budget and approving local policy. With that in mind, what are your goals for running for a Board of Education seat in Habersham County.
Well, yeah, as a matter of fact, those are two of the roles of a school board member. The third is to hire a superintendent. We have a darn good one with Mr. Cooper, who's here. But that's very important to for a board not to overreach and to stick to what exactly their role is. We've hired a good superintendent, a great superintendent. He has a staff, and they are responsible for the day-to-day managing of our school system. Accountability is important, and some standards are important. I mean, and teachers, you know, value those standards. If we are going to hold them accountable to a certain evaluation, they need to know what they need to teach. And our current standards are just a basis, just a benchmark. They are our standards. They are the Georgia standards, and I fully support our teachers while they implement those standards.
Okay, thank you, Doug.
Senator Foster, I'd like to say that, like Don said, that there's really like four duties of a school board member. One of the things that I would really like to look is more vision setting. There's a lot of things I know that he has mentioned that that the school system has done, but there's a lot more that we can improve on. As far as the board member policy making, that's our primary goal, and to hire a very good superintendent. Mr. Cooper's done a good job there. And as far as the standards and the teacher accountability, the state governs what we have to use as our evaluation for teachers. I actually went through that myself. There's some parts of it I do not agree with, and of course, you know, the standards and stuff, I'm against the Georgia Standards of Excellence because it's just another version of Common Core, but there's nothing that we can do about that. Because it's state mandated, but I will state for the record, though, I am against Common Core and any variation of that.
Okay, next question. Since the Board of Education has a responsibility for the largest budget in the county, what experience do you bring to the table on balancing budgets and making payroll? Doug?
Okay. One of the things that I did that a lot of people don't know, I was appointed the administrator for the entire state of Georgia of Key Club International. The Kiwanis governor of the state of Georgia back in 2008 appointed me, and I was over all the schools in the state of Georgia. I had to balance the budget of all the Key Club budget for the whole entire Georgia district. I also had to plan four state conventions by myself, procure all the hotels, all the entertainment, all the speakers, and balance all that budget. Plus four international conventions that we had to do tour groups. So I have a lot of experience outside the school system. Plus, I don't want the folks to, I want everybody, the voters, to be aware that teachers and coaches, we deal with budgets all the time anyway. We're constantly having to make ends meet where we need to cut, and the teachers have done a wonderful job. So the experience I bring to the table should be no problem, Senator Foster.
Okay, Don.
Well, first I can point to my experience on the board. Like I say, we've balanced budgets for the last 2 years. And my experience in private business, I've run my own general contracting company, been a realtor, and currently I manage eight stores across the upstate and into Toccoa. But I would have to say the biggest the best experience would be with the school board presently.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to another question. What is your plan to control spending in Habersham County to maintain or preferably lower our property taxes?
And that's mine.
Done.
Well, continuing the conservative spending practices, again, zero-based budgeting, competitive bidding that we've been doing, using different ways to reach out for even our construction bidding that we've been doing. These are all things that have been initiated in the last 3 years since I've been on the board. The local board has just around 10% that is not discretionary, that is not salaries. So that's pretty much the limit of what we can do in that large budget.
Okay. Doug.
Senator Foster, what I was looking at some of the surrounding counties and stuff on the millage rate, and believe it or not, we're pretty low with the school is with some of the counties. I mean, Stevens County is like 20. They've got a rate of 20 mills, and Habersham's currently at 4.7, but we're very competitive with banks and some others. To answer the question, though, the zero-based budget with what we're doing with the school system has been tremendous, because I was a part of that, and that has really helped maintain a lot of our spending. I will like to go on the record, though, when the state gives money back to teachers, I would not have hesitated whatsoever to give those teachers that pay raise, even if it's only for 1 year. And I want to make that publicly clear.
Okay, next question. With the length of time that can pass between a student's math or language classes, with our current block scheduling system, what are your thoughts and plans to alleviate this problem? Doug?
Well, first of all, there's been a lot of meetings and stuff, even during my last probably 5 or 10 years, I guess, in education, about block versus 7 6-period days. Once the teachers have got set in the block schedule, it's really hard to convince them to go back to the 7-period day. If you really look at it, you can find just as much pros as you can cons on it. I was against block schedule when we first got it. The reason is I think you try to teach too much, too fast, too quickly. And it doesn't, you have to have some time to absorb it, some time to practice it. But we were finding ourselves as teachers having to build on a concept, and as soon as we get through with it, add another concept in the same lesson. And so therefore, if you look at it that way, I think it's detrimental to the block. So it's just going to be education and looking and deciding what would be the best interest for our students and our teachers. But the bottom goal is what's going to be, just like the saying that the school board has, success for all students. I think that is our ultimate goal right there, to see our students succeed. So whatever would be the best is what I would pursue.
Okay. Don?
Both of the block and a standard and a hybrid schedule all have their merits. And anytime I ran into that with my son, where there was a long lapse between his math, it would have been a year and a half. But that just, I found that the high school was available. We affected a change in the schedule. And really the scheduling to me is something that needs to be left up to the administrators at the high school and the folks at the central office. That's what they do every day, and I would support whatever they propose.
Okay, final question. What are your thoughts on the value of charter schools? What is your opinion about making Habersham County a county charter system? Okay.
Well, we are in the midst, and actually I believe, I guess we could say we've been approved as a strategic waiver school. Which really gives our system a great deal of flexibility. I support, whatever education, choice a family wants to make, whether it's private school, homeschooling. The system that we have now set up with the strategic waivers system is really ideal for Habersham County.
Okay, Doc.
Senator Foster, I'd have to agree with Mr. Corbett there, but I have two children that graduated from Habersham Central High School, one in 2008 and one last year. My wife graduated, she's here with me now, she graduated from Habersham Central back in 1981. I'm just a proponent of public education. I would really feel like that, and she's giving me a look like now I've done told her age right there. I'm sorry, honey. Pam, you're also in that group too, though. Right? So, Pam Woolley's also in that group. But no, seriously, public education, what the students get socially, extracurricular and stuff, they really miss a lot when they do the charter and the homeschooling. And, but I think we've got a good system in place, but I'm definitely will support that.
Okay, closing statements. Okay, Doug, you're first.
Well, like I said earlier, I think that with the 31 years experience that I have in Habersham County, the relationships that I have built with athletes and students, and I'm going to tell you right now, if you head coach a sport at the high school level, you learn a lot about your community. You learn a lot about parents. And you learn that you gain a lot of loyalty and trust if you're a good coach. And I felt like that most people will tell you that I was a good coach. Might not have won all the time, but I was a good coach and I treated the students fairly. And so what I'm looking at is those relationships. Because one of the things that the board's got to have is got to have trust and support of the community. And I feel like I bring that to the table because I've got countywide people know me and they know that they can trust me and they know that what I say is what I'm going to do. So I really would appreciate your vote on May the 24th. And you'll vote Doug Westmoreland. That'll be after Don Corbett. Now it'll be alphabetically, so it won't have an I beside it. So I do appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Okay, Don.
Yes, I believe in public schools. Public school is more than just academics. It's agricultural programs, fine arts, athletics, and our career pathways. I know the role of a board member. It's simply to approve a budget, make a policy, and hire a superintendent. The role of a school board member is not to advocate for school teachers, and I support teachers. My wife is a teacher. Every one of us remember a teacher that had the greatest impact on our lives. For me, it was Mrs. Hill in sixth grade at Port Salerno Elementary. She's my friend on Facebook now. But all taxpayers need to be represented on the Board of Education. I'm the voice of business and free market on the school board, and without my continued service, we will have four retired educators on the board, and that's not a balanced and representative of the community. A vote for me will allow the Habersham County school system to continue on a path of progress that we've seen for the last 3 years, and I would appreciate your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. That's the Board of Education candidates, District 1, Don Corbett and Doug Westmoreland. Now we're back with the County Commissioners, District 5. And District 1. And tonight we have Ed Nichols, George Arnold, Dale Green, Sonny James, Stacy Hall. We'll start, first of all, with Ed Nichols.
Okay, thank you.
Opening statement.
Okay, thank you. Thanks to the Chamber of Commerce and the Farm Bureau for putting this on. I sat here 4 years ago and said, I'd like to be a county commissioner, and you voted me in. I've enjoyed it. I've never missed a meeting. I'm a conservative Republican, grew up in Clarksville, went to Young-Harris College, University of Georgia, worked for 30 years in management with three different companies, was executive director of the Chamber of Commerce for 7 years, and I love Habersham County. So we've done a lot of good things in the last 3.5 years. We hired a great county manager. We got a lot of things going on, and I'd like to serve 4 more years. Thank you.
Okay, next.
All right, my name is Sonny James. I'm sorry I don't have my hat on. My wife wouldn't let me wear it. Judy Taylor also told me not to wear it, so I decided I'd listen to him. I've been your county commissioner for the last 7.5 years. I grew up in Kinnear, Georgia, went to South Habersham High School. Don't hold that against me because we were the best.
No,
from
no,
there,
you weren't.
I went
no,
to,
no, no.
No, from there, I went to North Georgia College. I left here in 1966. I had to find a job. I came back in 98, and I found that we still had to have jobs in this county because our kids were leaving and not staying. I have been very active in the community. I've been out at least 3 days a week, and my wife will tell you probably more like 5 days a week. I listen to the people. I want to hear what you've got to say. Sometimes I disagree with you, and sometimes I will agree with you. But I do listen to your voice. I would appreciate your vote, and let me serve for 4 more years. Thank you.
Okay, next. Who's next?
Dale Green is next.
Okay, Dale Green.
I figured I might as well just get right in the middle of it. So I'm the fifth child out of a family of 8, so I'm used to being in the middle. You know what they say about middle children? They make good negotiators. So you might ought to remember that. I have lived in Habersham County for almost my entire life. My dad took cabinet making here at trade school in the 40s, and when I graduated from high school, I went to work with Dad and helped him do cabinet work here in the county. And a lot of you know us from that. Did that for almost till about 1989 and 90, till the building industry collapsed here in the county. After that, I went to work with Fieldale, and I worked with Quality Foods, for several years down there. Lee Arundale State Prison a couple of years, Hall County. I went to Athens and worked for a while. I have moved around quite a bit, and I'm very thankful that I did because it gave me a lot of experience. But I, the reason I'm involved, I wanted you to know, I think we need strong Christian voices in government now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And the next is Stacy Hall.
Thank you, Senator. Thank everybody for being here. It is a great crowd. I also want to thank the Habersham Chamber of Commerce as well as the Farm Bureau for having us. I'm part of a family that's been in Habersham for nearly 50 years. I think I bring a very unique background to the County Commission in that I've taught on every level of education, elementary school, middle school, high school. I've taught undergraduate and graduate level classes in college. Currently a business professor and athletic director at Tripp McConnell College. I've run medium, large-sized businesses. My wife and I currently own a small business here. Many of you know me. You know that I describe myself as a Christian, constitutionalist, conservative. My faith guides me in all that I do, guides my decision-making. We are active members at Bethlehem Baptist Church right down the street. I'm a constitutionalist, and I believe in the Constitution as it is written, nothing less, nothing more. And I'm a social and fiscal conservative. I believe in very limited, efficient government without any waste. My background provides me the opportunity to be very inquisitive about things. So I'll get into the other part of that before I got the red light blankets.
Okay. Thank you, Stacy. Okay. Next is
Locke Arnold.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a very distinguished person with us today. I'd like for him to be recognized. The Honorable Judge Crawford, he is one of the finest judges that we were blessed to have in this county. I just want you to stand up, Judge, stand up. He's a mentor of mine. My name is George Locke Arnold. I am 59 years old. I have one child. I've been in business in Clarksville for 35 years. Ladies and gentlemen, the county is a business. You have employees, you provide services, and you have a revenue base through the tax system. That's the way I will look at it, and no other way. When a business spends more than it makes, you're going to go in the hole and you're going to get in trouble. You cannot ball yourself out of debt. Stepping back just a little bit, 4 years ago, the only people in this building were the candidates themselves. I want you to just look around. We got people in here. They're very concerned about what's going on now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen. And now it's time to get into the questions. And I'm going to simplify this thing a little bit because if we start jumping around, I'm going to get confused. So I'm going to start with you, Mr. Arnold.
That'll work.
And then you'll be first. And then, okay. Ed, you'll be last when it comes to closing. Well, let's do it that way. So I do that for my own benefit. Okay, first question. How would you propose to promote collaboration between our seven municipalities and other government agencies to develop a solid economic development plan to attract industry and jobs to Habersham County? Okay.
I was on the Habersham County Water and Sewer Authority. I started at the bottom and I worked my way all the way up to chairperson. Ladies and gentlemen, when you have growth, you have a sewer system. You've got to have it. You can't work around it. It must be dealt with. A 3 million gallons per day sewer system will cost you around $30 million for a good one. Why 3 million? You need to go five. Growth costs money. And it's going to cost a fortune to put that stuff along 985, 365. Hall County's done a good job at it, but they got a lot of money. You got to have money to put it in the ground. They're not going to let you put it in the ground and you pay for them, you know, in 20 years. It's a very touchy situation, and everybody's going to have to work together. There's been things happen in the past that have destroyed the confidence between the people and the commissioners. They need to really look at that.
Okay, thank you very much. Stacy.
I think the first thing you have to do is be genuine, and you have to communicate with them. I've met with every mayor. I've met with most of the city managers. I've listened to their needs. I do not go in and thinking that I'm the smartest guy in the room. I don't want to be the smartest guy in the room. I want to listen to people. I think as a county commissioner, you're a representative. And there's this misconception, perhaps, that there's the county commission is somehow superior to municipalities. I could not disagree with that more. Both are very important to this community. Both have distinct roles, and we have to work together. I think one of the issues that we may get to, I'm assuming, is the radio maintenance fees. You know, that should have never happened. One of the reasons it happened is because we did not have the proper communication protocol in the front end. We have to be friends and work together as partners with our municipalities. That's step one. And then clear, concise information, make sure that we have intergovernmental agreements in writing to avoid any misunderstandings later on down the road. But we are one family, we are one community, and we've got to start acting like it. Thank you.
Okay. Dale, I believe you'd be next.
Okay. I think the cities are looking to the county for leadership. The cities are very important, and they have a job to do. But I really think the county needs to be the leader to step up and move things forward in Habersham County.
Sonny?
Well, I can go back 8 years when nobody was talking to each other in this county. And it stands right now, all the municipalities in the county are working together to make sure that we're doing what's right for this county and for the citizens of this county. We have come a long way, an awful long way. We have Demarest and Baldwin are now working together on water. We have to do something about economic development. And if you've read the paper lately, I put out 5 points in there as to what has to be done. We have declared 365 a corridor overlay, which is the beginning. We have been working on ordinances so that the county and the city can work together. And when business comes in here, they don't have to go to 4 or 5 different places to get it done. It's all the same, whether you're working in Kinnear or Clarksville. As far as water is concerned, the only way we're going to get water down there is that we work together, regardless of how it is. We have come a long way in this county, and we're going further. The cities and the counties, no one is more important than the other. They have to work together.
Okay, thank you, Sonny. Okay, Ed, you're next.
Well, I think he summarized it. When I joined the commissioners, I already knew a lot of the city folks from the Chamber of Commerce, and we've kept that communications going. And I think today we really got good communication between all 7 towns and the county commissioners. We work together. We've got mutual aid agreements on fire and safety. We've got intergovernmental agreements. Not blaming anybody, but years ago there should have been more intergovernmental agreements so everybody understood the cost of products, the cost of radios, and so forth. But we've got a good county manager, and the cities have good managers, and so they're all getting together, they're communicating, and that's the key, is just good communications.
Okay, Ed, you're going to get to start off with the next question. What special qualities or skills could you bring to the county commission?
Well, 30 years in management has helped me a lot, and a lot of that was in human resources, and we've instituted a lot of professional management practices in the county in the last 3 years. We put in a personnel evaluation system, a compensation system. We've redone the website. We've moved into a lot of professional development projects and management in the county, and I think my background has helped a little bit on that, particularly in human resources. We've got a pretty tight budget. We've got a good budget. We now have, we're required to have 17% of our budget in reserves. We now have 25%, and I think that's amazing, outstanding. That's in case we have a tornado, we need extra money. We've done a lot of good things. We saved the hospital, for one thing, so that's a whole other issue that still is out there. But that's about it.
Okay, Sonny.
Well, some of the qualities I think I bring to the county is that I have worked for the Army and Air Force Exchange Service for 30 years. During that time, I managed a store, I managed a warehouse, I managed different countries throughout. I've been in Europe, I've been in the Pacific, I've been in the Middle East, I've been all over the world and in the United States. It gives me an opportunity to see a lot of different local communities, a lot of different small communities, the ones that have been successful and the ones that have not been successful. I think I can bring that, and I have brought that to this county for the past 7.5 years. I am an expert negotiator because I've been negotiating all my life, not just with someone across the street, but with someone around the world. We have been working together. We have been working with the communities and the cities, and we have accomplished an awful lot. We got through the courthouse. We got through the hospital, and there's still some problems there, but we're working with that. We will get through the water and all, too. So I ask for your vote. Thank you.
Okay, Dale.
I started school in a private school called Habersham Mills School. That was in the first and second grade. I got off to a good start. I still remember the simplicity of that private school, and a lot of people still remember how that was. Then I moved into the public education system for the next 10 years. I learned how to add and subtract and to read and write. I'm not sure everybody's learning to do that now, but those are certainly good qualifications to get the job done.
Okay, Stacy.
Well, I have experience in sales and marketing. I was a veteran sales and marketing executive, and I run budgets in companies worth you know, millions and millions of dollars. But I think the most important thing for me, I think, is relational skills that I bring to the table. I can look around the room and see many folks with whether it's Archway, school system, Farm Bureau, a lot of business owners, the newspaper, Chamber of Commerce, what have you. And I've got relationships with those folks. And the county manager, I see Don Anderson in the back with Cornelia. You got to have relationships with folks when you're working with the local government. It's extremely important. I'm going to listen to those folks. I respect those folks. I'm not smarter than those folks. I am hopefully if you vote for me, will be a representative of each and every one of you here. So I will listen to you. Also, I think passion. I love this community. This is the greatest community on earth. I truly believe that. This is where we chose to raise our family. I bring the passion to the table. I bring new energy to the table. I think because of my background in business and education, I can bring fresh ideas and creative solutions to the table. So I'm asking for your vote tonight. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And then Arnold.
You must have business experience. You must know how to run a business. Now, if you work for somebody for 30 or 40 years, that's fine. Your check came on in and you cashed it and you went home. Private business experience, I've been doing it for 35 years. I started out with nothing. And it is mandatory. You've got to hire people, and then, unfortunately, every now and then, you got to fire them. And if you can't do it, you don't have any business being a commissioner.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next question, and George, we'll start with you on this one. What is your plan for paving dirt roads in Habersham County to save road maintenance costs for the county? You want to answer that?
Me.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It costs money. The initial investment is tremendous, but it saves money. All there is to it, that saves money. Asphalt now, it's a science. They've got that figured out. You get a good base, you put the asphalt down, you've got it. Asphalt or concrete, that's the only way to go.
Next, Stacy.
Well, anytime I make a decision, I'm going to do a detailed cost analysis. And that starts with making sure you have all the data and all the information. I think it's very important that we don't make any knee-jerk reactions. Now, there may be times where there's folks that are riled up and very passionate about their position, and they'll come into county commissioner meetings, and they'll make a fuss, and you've got to be careful. That might not be the majority of the folks, and that might not be the best use of all of our taxpayers' money. So you can't make decisions based on popularity. You have to do your due diligence, and maybe that's just the professor in me. But I'm going to do my due diligence. I'm going to do my homework when it comes to making decisions, such as paving the roads, or if that's a great use of taxpayers' money. Because government has no money, as you all know. It's your money. I'm not going to spend your money unless I've done my homework and a cost analysis and due diligence. So I think that's very important. And I'm not sure that always happens in all levels of government. Thank you.
Okay, Dale, you're next.
I think there are changes we can make If I got all my figures correctly when I spent a good bit of time checking into things, we spend, counting county, state, and federal money in this county, almost $100 million a year. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. But there are a lot of changes that we can make in the way we do things and whatever we've got to do. When I worked at Lee Arundel State Prison, they came in there in 2005 and said, as a state employee now, they said, we're going to make changes. My salary went from $48,000, it would go back to $26,000 or what I had made that next year. I was able to adjust and move on. Sometimes you've got to make changes and adjust and take care of what we've got to do.
Sonny?
I'm not going to sit up here and tell you we're going to pave all the roads in Habersham County because I don't think that's possible. A lot of those roads are not county roads, they're private roads. And the county cannot spend money paving private roads. Where we can, we do pave private roads. We try to make it as easy as possible to get in and out of. Because as we all know, we have snow, we have a lot of rain up here, and those roads get very bad. If they're not paved, we go out and grade them, and we put, rocks over them. But we are definitely gravel, that's what I was trying to think of, gravel over them. But we're not going to pave all the roads in Habersham County. And anyone tells you that we are, I'd be a little leery of. Thank you.
Okay, Ed.
Well, we have a little over 400 miles of paved road and a little over 110 miles of dirt road, county roads, not private. It's a dilemma. the county would love to have all the roads paved. It's cheaper. We buy a lot of gravel, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of gravel. But Georgia has a law that says that you can't take somebody's land, and we don't use eminent domain, so we go to the people and say, would you give your right of way? And a lot of people don't want to do that. A lot of people don't want to give up their right of way. Consequently, we have a lot of dirt roads, and they will always be there until the people come and say, we want a road paved. Here's, everybody agrees. And when we do that, we're doing one right now where all the 18 citizens got together and said, we want our road paved. It's horrible. And we're doing it today. They all had to sign and give us a 60-foot right-of-way, 30 feet from center line, either way. So paved roads are a good thing. Save some buying gravel.
Okay, we're on the last question, and we'll start with you, Ed, on this one. What are your thoughts on what to do with the old courthouse?
I think I'll go one. This is, as you know, is under consideration what to do for an administration building. This county needs an admin building to serve all the offices not in the new courthouse. Some people have said, okay, put it in the fourth floor of the new courthouse. That fourth floor is reserved for the Superior Court. We're the headquarters for the Mountain Judicial Circuit. And once Habersham, Rayburn, and Stevens counties reach 100,000, we'll have another judge and a large courtroom and offices in that fourth floor. We can't put them up there. So we're going to have to build a building or redo the old courthouse. The figures we have right now, and Sonny will tell you the same thing, it's exorbitant, the amount of money that had to be spent on the pig, as I call it, putting lipstick on the pig. Because the plumbing shot, the electricity shot, the roof's bad, it's got black mold, bricks are falling off the outside. There's 50 things wrong with it. Do we put money into it? That's what we're going to be talking about for the next month or two. We're going to make a decision. But we want to have an energy efficient. Oh, excuse me. Okay.
Sonny.
Okay, I'll pick it up there. The commission is currently looking at 5 different locations to put an administration building. One of them is the old courthouse. One of them is to tear that courthouse down and put it behind where it is. But there's a lot of grading and all that's to do there. The other one is put it behind the new courthouse judicial center down there where the old North Habersham practice field was. Put it down there. It's going to cost money. You've got a creek. You've got to be a buffer there. You also have a neighborhood right behind that, which causes a lot of traffic. You've also got to change the roads on Sanford Mill Road, make it wider. There's a lot of things there. The next one is the GDOT. Area out on 17, we've got about a 2.18 acres out there. There's problems with that. There's been some talk about Jacob's Way right there next to the Aquatic Center to make it a campus-type arena, and we're looking at that. But until the commission gets all the specifics, cost estimates and everything else, we've got to evaluate that before we make a decision.
Cadell?
I still think the old courthouse needs to be looked at very closely. I am not convinced that it cannot be used and used in a good manner.
Stacy?
Well, I've got a little bit of unique idea. I would give everybody a sledgehammer and charge them a dollar a swing to knock that thing down. And I think we could pay for any cost we had. But that's a very great question in all seriousness. And I appreciate Mr. James outlining some of the options. But folks, we can't do any of those options until we do come to a resolution on what we're going to do with that old building. The initial, and I don't have a final decision on it, but the initial numbers that I've seen would make it cost prohibitive to bring that building up to code. There's so many issues with that building, I don't think we could do it. So what I would propose we doing is working collaboratively on coming up with a win-win situation with the city of Clarksville and try to capture some grant funding to make it tear that building down, put some nice mixed-use facilities around the square, attract more businesses to help generate economic development for community, commercial, industrial tax revenue. I think there's a lot of creative solutions we could get to, but we've got to come up with that solution first before we really start digging in and making a decision on where we're going to put a new administrative building. Thank you.
Okay, George.
The old Ingalls property is available. The square footage is massive. Go in there and gut it, drop the ceiling, throw down some carpet, put in cubicles. It's an open-air design building. Putting in cubicles, that'll age adjustment. You can change your office space. I'd leave that building the way it is. Don't spend a dime on it. Go to Ingalls, buy that, retrofit that whole section. Put the tax office, public safety building there, retrofit that, buy it, and put that to a good use admin building, and it'd make an outstanding building, and it'd last a long time. Good money, well spent. We're talking $7 million, people. That's what they're saying, $7 million. What about three? What's wrong with three? I don't understand it. Why not save money instead of dadgum spending it?
Okay, time for closing statements, gentlemen. And we're going to begin with you, Ed.
Okay, well, one other thing on the administration building. It's when I joined when I was elected the commissioner, one of the first things that jumped out at me was the amount of money we spend on rent. Last year, this county spent over $200,000 in rent and utilities. And that's what we're striving to get away from. We've moved the public defender out of a rental building into the old magistrate building, which is the old health department. So we're saving over $2,000 a month there. So we got to do something, and one of the things we'll do is hopefully get out of renting buildings. We don't need to be renting buildings. It's been fun 4 years or 3.5 years, and we've done a lot of good things. As I mentioned earlier, we now have a nice fund balance. We've taken over the operation of the senior center. We've converted to County transit program to not losing money, and that's breaking even. For the first time ever, we're making a profit at the airport, and that's a major thing. We'll be finishing in the next year or two the parallel taxiway. Fantastic airport, about 70 planes down there. So it's an economic engine. We're working on a lot of projects, and I enjoy it, and I hope you'll let me work on them for 4 more years. Thank you.
Okay, Sonny James, you're next.
First, I'd like to thank the Farm Bureau and the Chamber for having this, and for you, for the people here coming out and listening to this, and for the questions that have been answered. There are multiple answers to each and every one of them questions. I hope that you have enough confidence in your county commissioners that they have looked at all the options possible, because I don't know of one of them that wouldn't like to save you money. As far as this county is concerned, I love this county. I came back to this county to raise my family, and my family's already raised. So Marcia and I came back. I love it, and you can ask anyone about it. Every meeting I go to, I try to tell them how great Habersham County is. In fact, I did in Europe. I told them that the mountains in Habersham were a lot prettier than the Alps. The other thing I'd like for you to do is remember that I have no other motive or agenda other than to serve the people of this county. I've done that for 7.5 years. I'd like to do it for another 4 years, and then you can let me go. But I would love to continue the service that I've given and to continue the effort that I've put in, along with the other commissioners, of getting this accomplished.
Okay. Dale Green, closing statement.
I'd like to spend my time closing and addressing two items that will be on the ballot in May. Both of them are concerning the sale of alcoholic beverages in the county. I was raised in an alcohol-free home. My children were raised in an alcohol-free home. Too much alcohol is flowing in Habersham County. If you drink sweet tea, you don't have to worry about DUIs and breathalyzers and domestic violence that results from it. Kool-Aid, lemonade, still is good to drink. I urge the pastors of this county to ask their members to vote no on both of those ballots, on both of those items, and I will do the same. Thank you.
Okay. Stacy Hall.
As I said earlier, we live in an absolutely wonderful place. I believe it's the greatest place on earth to live, but we're going to face many challenges. There's a lot of discussion now about developing 365 corridor, and I'm in favor of that in an intentional, strategic, carefully planned out way, because we don't want to be Hall County. We don't want to be Gwinnett County. We want to protect our Habersham values. We want to protect our Habersham way of life. And I think that's very important. And that starts with having a detailed plan, a marketing plan, and how we attract businesses. You know, I want to work with my business and education background. I want to help build a consortium between our school system, between our local colleges, and our businesses, the private sector, and helping build a workforce, building a workforce. That was one of the, as I go around the community and I talk to business owners, one of the biggest issues is hiring people to find jobs. So that's an important part of it. Last thing I would say is, I'm bringing passion and energy to the table to work for our community, and I think that's important. I'm asking for your vote, but if you do not vote for me, I'm asking that you vote for everybody. I'm asking that you pray for everybody in office, whether it's me or whoever. We have got to start getting on our knees more in this country and praying for our leaders, and I'm asking you to do that and join me in that regard, no matter who you vote for. Thank you.
George Arnold, your final statement.
I'd like to thank everybody for showing up tonight. We got a good crowd here. People are concerned now, and they should be, rightfully so. Money does not grow on trees. There has to be a stopping point somewhere. If you might want it, you might need it, but you better be a responsible person, a responsible county government. You better figure out how you're going to pay for it. You look at that hospital. We have got to pay for that hospital. That is our debt. So let's stop kicking the can, get responsible, get off our butts, and pay that sucker. We have got to pay our debts. And we're not going to do anything until we start doing it. Nobody's going to, you know, get responsible, and let's tighten up the belts, and let's all work together.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen. Note now that Ed Nichols, George Arnold, and Dale Green are running for District 5, and Sonny James and Stacy Hall, District 1. Gentlemen, thank you. Now we're going to be listening to the judge for probate court. And we have running for that office Pam Worley, Lauren Craig, and Jarvis McFarland. Pam, we're going to start with you, your first opening statement.
Well, hello, and my name is Pam Worley, and I'm seeking re-election as your probate judge. I've lived my entire life in Habersham County and the Clarksville area, actually. I live about 2 miles from where I grew up 52 years ago, thanks to Mr. Westmoreland there. I have been employed by Habersham County since March the 2nd of 1987. I started my employment with Habersham County in the tax commissioner's office, where I worked as deputy clerk for, well, a little over 6 years. From there, I transferred to probate court, where I worked for 15 plus years as a deputy clerk. From there, I transferred to Habersham County Magistrate Court as the bookkeeper, and I was employed there till I became probate judge. I was fortunate enough to win the election in 2011. So I've been serving as probate judge since April 22nd of 2011. As you can see, and it's from the heart, public service to Habersham County has been my whole life's work. I love Habersham County. I love to serve the citizens of Habersham County. And I really want to continue as your probate judge.
Okay, thank you, Pam. Next, we'll hear from Lauren Craig.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to thank Chamber of Commerce and Farm Bureau for this evening. My name is Lauren Craig. I am an attorney in Clarksville. I graduated Habersham Central, University of Georgia, and went to John Marshall Law School down in Atlanta. I've got a successful practice here in Clarksville. My practice centers around probate law and real estate. I do a little civil practice as well. I really enjoy helping the people of Habersham County. Nothing brings me more pleasure than to be able to help people through things. Part of the job of a probate judge is to help people through the hardest times of their life, be it guardianships or conservatorships, death certificates, things of that nature. Your life is in the probate court, and I hope that you'll help me help you take care of those things for you. Thank you.
Okay, Jarvis McFarland.
Good evening. I am Jarvis McFarland. I am a native of Franklin County. I have lived in Habersham for the last 40 years. I'm an accountant by profession. I graduated from Piedmont College. I have a master's in business from Brunel University, and I maintain my EA credentials by the IRS and the Department of Treasury. And I'm also a member of the National Association of EAs. I was employed by Standard Telephone Company for the first 25 years of my career until the merger with Alltel. At that time, I started my own business and doing accounting and taxes. It's in that area that I become familiar with wills, being executor, trustee. I am currently a guardian and conservatorship of an incapacitated adult. I have done extensive volunteer work for the county and the citizens of this county. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Time for questions now. And let's start with you, Pam. I'm going to go over this the way they're listed here in the bulletin. If elected, what will be your first priority in office?
Well, things are running really, really good there now. And all our cases are current, gun permits. Although there's so many, they're caught up and current. The only thing is that I would like to see happen is we do a lot of 1013s, which is an affidavit to apprehend. There's nothing in Georgia now that's, in other words, you can't do something to someone, and which is a good thing to some degree, but if somebody's really got mental illness and they refuse help, there's nothing that can be done if they refuse to go. I think that would be. It'd be great if something was done in that aspect to help people get the help they need, other than a court order sometimes.
Okay, and Jarvis?
The thing I would like to change about our probate office is I would like to see us become more proactive in the area of estate planning. Estate planning is going to be a key item to the future of our county and our nation. If you don't start estate planning at an early age, you're in trouble by the time you get to the point to where somebody wants to execute your will. So I think estate planning is a key item that we need to work on in this county.
Okay. Lauren, I skipped you in the proper order. But anyhow, you got the floor.
I knew I'd be up. If I were to be able to be allowed to serve y'all as probate judge, my primary concern is to help the folks that come in the office every day. I'm also a Georgia certified mediator, which means I've been trained to listen to all sides, to every side, about every issue. Might not agree on all of them, doesn't matter, I listen. Might not go the way you want it to go, but I promise you I'll listen to your side. Ultimately, the law is what is going to decide things. The law. I am a lawyer. I've learned it. I study it. I'm every day. I'm in it. I've got experience in it. And ultimately, that is what is going to decide things. Not my personal views, not anything else that might come before me. The law is what makes that decision. And I will do those decisions for you. Thank you.
Okay. Lauren, we'll start the next question with you. The elderly often need assistance when they can no longer manage their affairs. How do you balance the rights of the elderly and their need for guardianship?
Well, I've done a few guardianships myself, and I've been in Judge Woolley's court a few times for these same things and filed for guardianships and conservatorships, which is the business side of things. Often, our loved ones are the last ones that want to let go. Sometimes we have to step in and do these things for them. They might not always want them, but the idea is that they get a fair hearing. If you apply for a guardianship for someone, that person is given an attorney to listen to, or that attorney will listen to their side of the things and decide, help decide for them that they're being represented and their side is being heard. It's very important that we remember we have to take care of these folks. This population of this county is aging. The elderly have increased in this county. This is a huge retirement community. More and more, this comes before a probate judge. It gets busier and busier every year. And I feel that we have to pay attention, make sure these folks are getting the help and care that they need, make sure that they are protected. And I promise to do that as your probate judge.
Thank you. Pam?
I agree completely with Mr. Craig there, because sometimes the older people don't actually know what's best for them. So a lot of them have Alzheimer's and dementia. It's hard to do, but you've got to do what's best for that elderly person or for that minor. We do a lot of minor guardianships as well. You've got to look after their best interest on whatever you do.
Jarvis?
Back to what I was saying earlier about estate planning. My views are that if we do good estate planning in this county, that we will not be in that situation as often as we are right now. I know people are, you know, sometimes when they let it slip up on them, but if a person starts at early age planning for the worst, then they will be ready when that day comes.
Okay. Jarvis, we'll start with you on this next question. This question has already been referred to by all three of you, but it won't hurt. Maybe you got two or three other things you want to add, but what experience do you have that uniquely qualifies you to hold this office?
Well, like I said earlier, I do have experience being executor of estates. I've been trustees of estate, and right now I am a guardian and conservator of a incapacitated adult. I have extensive knowledge in how to run an office, how to make things flow, and get things done. And that's usually my general attitude is to get it done and get it done correctly.
Pam?
I think my 29 years with the county goes a long way on experience there. I love the Habersham County, and I want to just continue serving.
Okay. Next, Lauren.
I think the biggest thing I bring to this office is that I am an attorney. That is not all that I am. I'm also, as I've said, a mediator, trained to listen, trained to make decisions. I've also been a private business owner. I haven't been a lawyer my entire life. I've worked a lot of different jobs. I've had very successful businesses, and I've got a successful practice now. I've got every skill that you would normally want for a person to have this job, plus I'm an attorney. I think that's a big plus. The law is what I do now. The law is what I look at every day. And I think that you need someone who is going to do that for you, because the population of this county is not what the state of Georgia requires to have a lawyer be a probate judge, honestly. You're supposed to be 96,000 and then you're a judge. You have to be an attorney to be a judge. I'm not sure why it's less important for you to be represented properly if we have a lower population. I think that regardless of the population, you need to be represented by the best person available. And for this job as a judge, it's an attorney. Thank you.
Okay, Lauren, we'll start with you on this question. Does the Habersham Probate Court no longer perform wedding ceremonies? If not, why not?
I believe the probate judge can still marry
folks. It's up to the judge.
You
want to
come in?
It's up to the judge's decision.
Who
was the question for?
It was for me, but I'm
starting with you.
But
going back.
Pardon?
I'm starting with you and then I'm going back to Charles.
Yeah, it's if the judge's discretion whether or not they perform a wedding ceremony, and that is up to the judge.
Okay, Pam.
And that's my answer as well. I've done quite a few ceremonies since I've been judge, but it got to where there were being so many of them, I couldn't do the hearings that I needed to do. So I stopped doing the ceremonies.
Okay.
But we still issue that marriage licenses.
Okay, Jarvis.
I have no problem doing marriage ceremonies, no.
Okay. Okay, we'll start down there with you, Jarvis, coming back. What's the annual budget for the probate office? Are there areas to implement spending cuts or improvements?
Well, I'm thinking, yes, that the office can be improved such that that we could reduce spending. I know that a lot of people probably don't believe that, but I have worked in many areas with many people from the financial standpoint and have found areas to cut and areas to save money. And I think that's a big thing that I'm going to bring to the table.
Okay, Pam.
And there's probably, I think the budget right now is, I'm not sure exactly what it is, I'm going to guess $100,000, but the commissioners do all our budgeting. So, you know, I'm sure if they could cut it, it's been cut. Peace.
Okay. Next, Lauren.
Okay. I'm sure there's almost always a way to cut some money and save some money in every office that there is. You know, one of the things which I take advantage of myself as well as a lot of my fellow lawyers, we're able to file things and not have to pay immediately and things like that. But, you know, collecting that money is a source of income for the county. And don't bill me tomorrow, but I think that collecting that money up front is a very good idea, particularly people who are filing pro se, which means they're not represented by an attorney. Sometimes, perhaps, they're not in a hurry to pay. We know folks like that. We all have people like that in our lives. And I think getting that money up front is the surest way to protect the funds that the county has to use from probate court.
Okay, that's the questions that we have before us. Now the closing statements. Jarvis, we'll begin with you.
Well, to continue on with that last statement there, I have a little problem with the county commission deciding what the probate office budget is. I think I'm well capable of deciding that myself and deciding how to spend it. Having said that, I have, you know, extensive financial background. I've done a lot of volunteer work for this county. I've worked with the Boy Scouts, the Habersham Christian Learning Center, and this past tax season, I did over 70 tax returns free to senior adults at the Cornelia Public Library. The Office of Probate Office is kind of interesting in that when you go in the courthouse, and I don't know if any of y'all been in the courthouse or the probate office is, but you go to the last corner, and you know, that's another problem I have is, you know, that we ask people to come to the probate office, and you go to the very last corner of the building to find it, and if I get elected, I have a few things on my agenda there. Thank you.
Pam.
All right, I agree with that. I think it needs to be more accessible for the elderly people. We had no input over where we were going, or I assure you it would have been a different place. But I just asked, with my years' experience, my love of people, my love of the county, I asked for your vote and I asked for your prayers. Thank you.
Okay, Lauren.
Again, I'd like to thank the Chamber of Commerce and the Farm Bureau for having us here tonight and giving me an opportunity to speak to everybody. I wasn't born in this county, but I did go to high school here. I've traveled a lot in my life. This is my favorite place in the world. Of all the countries I've been to and everything else, there's no place I'd rather be. This is the area my father, Rembert Craig, is from. He's the finest man I know. Everything I do, I ask myself, what would my dad do? This job means a lot to me. I look forward to the opportunity to be able to help everybody every day. I don't like the idea of not being a positive impact on my community. I look for you, please give me that opportunity to be that for you. Thank you.
Okay, well, that's it for the probate judge of probate court. We're back now, and this time we're going to be hearing from the two candidates for the clerk of Superior Court. It's David Wall and Joanne L. Jones. And David, we'll start with your opening statement.
All right. I'm David Clyde Wall. I'm clerk of Superior Court here in Habersham County and have been since 2005. When I took office in 2005, I took my oath very seriously to serve the citizens of Habersham County. Under my leadership, the office has been brought into compliance in several areas, such as good through dates and security of records, timely disbursements, online access to property records, and bringing the clerk's authority bank accounts being used by the office into proper resolution with the county commission. My competency speaks for itself. 11 audits without issue, reducing the annual budget by $90,000, consolidating processes and responsibilities, and running the office efficiently. Your clerk of court's office operates in compliance and stands on its own record. I am a working clerk, and I'm available to anyone who has business with the office.
Okay, thank you. Joanne?
Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. I am Joan Llewellyn Jones. I have 27 years experience in the court system, including as clerk and chief deputy clerk of the juvenile, magistrate, state, and superior. I'm excited to tackle the issues in the clerk's office and promise to make the following changes when elected. Unlike my opponent, I will not accept a $25 person payment for every U.S. passport application the county receives. I will not personally benefit from this service, which is used by taxpayers' money. I will cross-train employees to ensure trained people are available. I will eliminate wasted taxpayers' money by only subpoenaing witnesses and law enforcement when they are required to come to court. I will communicate with the parties, attorneys, prosecutors, judges, and to assure court calendars are accurate. I will revise the billing practice to ensure that phantom billing is eliminated. I will accurately, timely report, collect data, and ensure that it's captured, stored, and transmitted.
Questions? If elected or re-elected, what will be some of your priorities for the office in the future? Start with you, David.
Okay, thank you. One of the main priorities that I would have is moving forward with the electronic records within the office. We've made several cutbacks in the office in the area of real estate with not printing real estate books anymore. The records are kept electronically and backed up in three locations. We are currently working, and I want to continue to work toward the historical records being digitized and made available electronically. Right now, we are working on a project that goes back to 1964. Many people have already benefited from the plats, which all plats are already digitized and available. And many people that used to have to physically leave their office, come to the clerk of court's office, can now access those from their office electronically. Also, I'm sorry.
Okay. You want to respond to this too?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
My first priority would be the steward of the taxpayers' money. Then, when you can list everything else.
Okay. Is that all?
Yes.
Okay. We're going to start with you with the next question. How are fees assessed by the clerk of court's office from licenses and passports recorded and deposited? We'll start with you.
When licenses... repeat that again, please.
I say... How are fees assessed by the clerk of court's office from licenses and passports recorded and deposited?
How they're deposited? That would be on a daily basis.
Okay. Okay. David, you want to comment on that?
Yes. The all monies are deposited daily. The records receipting is all cashed out at the end of the day. And the next morning, those are kept locked in a safe. Overnight, the next morning, they are the deposits are all made. As far as fees that are assessed, all of our fees are set by the legislature. The clerk of court does not have the authority to set those fees. Fines, fees, and surcharges, as well as simply every fee basically in the office. There is a fee schedule that is put out by the state, and you alluded to passport fees. Those are set and mandated by the U.S. Department of State, and they're deposited and handled just as all other deposits and and accounting records, and audited every year.
Thank you.
I emphasize on that, please?
You had your turn, but go ahead.
All right.
Quickly.
There should be a daily closeout every day. That should be deposited that day to take care of any elimination.
Okay. All right, David, we'll begin with you on this question. Okay. Both of you have stated that you are certified by the Carl Benson Institute of Government at the University of Georgia. Please elaborate on the type of certification you hold. Give us some information about that.
Okay. I am a certified clerk of Superior Court through the Carl Benson Institute of Government at the University of Georgia. The courses for that are, there's 13 courses that are available. It typically takes about 4 years to complete those. It is not simply continuing education credits. It can be a part of your continuing education credits. However, it is a structured certificate program and is available to clerks of Superior Court. There is a clerk of court certification program from municipal clerks and through Carl Vinson, and that is the, I believe, the only ones that I am aware of that they have. Once you complete the 13 courses, you may take the annual update courses each year as available by the Carl Benson Institute.
Okay. Joanne, you want to react
to
that?
Yes, I am a certified clerk, and I'm also certified through the Carlton Benson Institute and also with continuing education through the University of Georgia.
Okay. Thank you. Next question. We'll start with you, Joanne. What is the annual budget for the clerk's office, and are there areas to implement spending cuts, in your judgment?
Yes, there is a lot of areas. You can use grant money if that grant money is out there to be used. There's many times that there is grant money, and that grant money would save a lot of money.
Okay. David? Okay.
We have made several cuts in the budget over the last few years. Some of those budgets weren't very popular. There has been, as I mentioned a while ago, $90,000 in cuts that have been made over the course of the last few months, actually. And some of that was done through some consolidation of services. There was, after the consolidation of the magistrate court duties under the placed back under the clerk of Superior Court, the magistrate court had a software program that was sufficient for magistrate court. It was not sufficient for and did not have the capabilities necessary for Superior and State. So I eliminated that that software. And the software that we do have for State and Superior would accommodate magistrate.
Okay. Thank you. We'll start with you. Joanne, you want to give your closing statement?
Sure. I'm a certified clerk for 27 years. If I wasn't certified, there's no way that I could keep my job. As clerk, I will treat you and all employees with respect and greet you with a smile. This is the most important duty as to guard the taxpayers' money, your money. I will eliminate waste in the clerk's office by cross-training eliminating phantom billing, eliminating issuing subpoenas, witnesses, and law enforcement when they are not needed. I will communicate with parties, attorneys, prosecutors, and judges to ensure that all court calendars are correct so that court system will work efficiently. I will not accept personal payment for U.S. passports as a $25 per person. This service is used by county equipment, facilities, paper, postage, a county employee, and yet my opponent personally benefits from this county action, and I will not benefit from this county source. I am Joan Llewellyn Jones, and I appreciate your vote.
Okay. Thank you, Joanne. David, closing statement.
All right. Thank you. I have received the 9th Judicial District Administrative Court Clerk's Integrity Award. That was a direct reflection on the operation of the Clerk of Court's office in Habersham County, in which I'm very proud and honored to be able to be recognized by those clerks of the 15 counties in this district. It was alluded to that that the subpoenas would only be issued in areas where that they are absolutely necessary. The Clerk of Court does not have the authority to decide who's subpoenaed and who is not. That is provided to the Clerk of Court by the prosecutors and attorneys, and you follow that direction. I'd like to close in a quote from Helen Keller. Helen Keller was once asked what could be worse than being blind. She made a very profound statement when she said, being able to see but having no vision. I continue to have a vision for the clerk's office here in Habersham County, and I ask for your vote and support in this upcoming election.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. We want to keep moving along here if we can. It's already past 7:30, and we still have a lot to go. We're going to be listening now to the Chief Magistrate Judge candidates. And the first speaker will be Gerald Johnson with your opening statement, sir.
Well, good evening. My name is Gerald Johnson. I'm the Chief Magistrate of Habersham County. I was given an amazing opportunity by the Superior Court judges here in our Mountain Circuit back in July of 2014 to serve in this capacity. There's really not a whole lot special to say about me other than I graduated from Habersham Central in 1988, and I've spent most of my life as a public servant. I've been in law enforcement most of my career, with my last assignment being the chief investigator of the Raven County Sheriff's Office. Since my appointment, we've used technology to advance the magistrate court and create a safer environment for not only the people in court, but also the people involved in the jail staff and the parties involved with the teleconferencing, as opposed to the transporting of prisoners to the courthouse. We're going to continue to move forward and build on that technology. And like I said, it's just an amazing opportunity, and I certainly appreciate your prayers, support, and most importantly, your vote to continue what we've started.
Okay. I may mess up on this one. Is it Savannah Trulak? Help me on that.
You're closer.
Close enough? Okay. May I just call you Savannah?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's a sophisticated way to say Savannah. Okay.
It's two and one. That would be the more correct way. So it didn't really matter. You've been called by my name. You work for the law enforcement. First of all, I want to thank you, the Lord Jesus Christ, for giving me this opportunity to be here, and especially for the Habersham County citizens. I have been in Habersham County for 30 years. I have been serving in law enforcement nearly 20 years consecutively. So I'm a Navy veteran. Thank you, the veterans, and thank you, their family who serve. I know that when the man is out, the woman hold together. Thank you for that. I graduated from North Georgia College and State University in Lumpkin County with my bachelor's degree in criminal justice. I also received my master's degree in divinity at Columbia Theological Seminary. I'm also a Sunday school teacher at First Presbyterian Church in Cornelia. So I'm a member there since 1996. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now for the first question. We'll start with you, Mr. Johnson. If elected, what will be your first priority in the office as far as improvements or anything of that sort?
My first priority will be what my priority has always been, and that's to protect the rights of the citizens, because I believe in the Constitution of the United States, and I believe that a magistrate is that reasonable and prudent person that's referred to in the law that hears the evidence and makes a determination of whether or not there should be an arrest warrant or a search warrant concerning the Fourth Amendment issues. When we're conducting hearings, I think that the Eighth Amendment issues is paramount as far as unreasonable fines and unreasonable bonds, and certainly the 14th Amendment, which provides for equal justice for everyone under law, and that to continue that.
Okay. Savano, you want to take that?
Yes, sir. Magistrate Court is a unique court in our judicial system. It might be one of the lowest judicial system it is, but it's really important people to understand that without magistrate court, it is difficult for the state and the Supreme Court to have a free time, well, not really a free time, to have more important hearing of the cases, the bigger and better one. So as I elected, the several thing that I would continue doing is to serve the community of Sam Habersham citizens. That's what I have been doing for the last 20 years, close to it. So, thank you.
Okay, Savannah, you got the next question. What is the annual budget for the Chief Justice Magistrate Court? And what are the areas to implement spending improvements in your judgment?
Well, Magistrate's Court is funny the way you say Chief Magistrate Court. You know, in our county, we don't have one magistrate. You have a part-time magistrate court, which budget shouldn't be that much money because it's just a salary. Before, it used to be a full-blown department, but no longer is that because it got converted to judge. The judge and the part-time judge. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Johnson.
Well, first of all, the magistrate court is a full-time court. In addition to being a full-time court, it's a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week court, and I don't know if a lot of people realize that or not, but we're on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to consider exigent circumstances. As far as the budget amount is concerned, I can't tell you right off the top of my head without looking at the paperwork, but it's somewhere in the neighborhood of $200,000. And that is actually, in 2015, I decreased the budget by approximately $35,000. And prior to that, we, with all the duplication of services and the consolidation of services, we have saved the county taxpayers considerably, thousands of tax dollars, in addition to not only the county, but we've also saved the taxpayers of the municipalities money through using the teleconferencing and some of the technology that's available that's helped us to streamline and bring our court into the 21st century.
Okay, yeah.
Can I rebut that?
Huh?
Okay.
All right, next question. What are the top two priorities of this office, and what will you do to improve them? We'll start with you, Gerald.
Well, like I said earlier, the main priority of the magistrate is to protect the rights of the citizens. And, you know, the magistrate is that fair and neutral and detached, reasonable and prudent person that is there to consider matters that come before it. And you know, what we'll do to continue that is what I've been doing. We're going to keep doing the building on the technology that we're using to make things run effectively and efficiently. And we're going to continue to provide a service, for example, the spreading the court hearings out so that we're having different hearings on different days to accommodate litigants in magistrate court. That will, you know, to make it the quick and easy way to get your cases heard in front of a reasonable and fair person.
and we're going to continue what we've been doing. I think my track record speaks for itself, and if you're not that familiar with magistrate court, I'd encourage you to come sit in with us.
Okay, thank you. Savannah?
First of all, I worked for the magistrate courts for 8 years. I understand the concept of serving the citizen of this county. Second of all, that when Mr. Johnson said that he had saved the county money, he meant he returned the salary money. He don't have any budget to begin with. So that being said, that what I want to do is to protect the constitution of the Habersham County citizens. That's what we did. That's what the magistrate court do. So some say that believe in the constitution. Some will die for the constitution. I'm one of those persons who died for the Constitution. I served in the military. As for the magistrate court concerned, the second issue is that I would not do the internet intercom because that's confidential information. If people can easily steal the PIN number and will accept the warrant issued or whatever thing that is done, so that right there is a matter of a private record. Thank you.
Okay, the final question for you, Savannah, is the expediency that court cases move through this office acceptable? If not, what would you do to improve them?
Can you question it one more time?
Is the expediency that court cases move through this office acceptable? If not, what would you do to improve this?
Well, I don't know, Judge, that I have served, it's really difficult for certain cases. But as well, you can do improvement by have multiple court sessions. That will be helping some other people that could come in and or have time to have the time that they're not going to spend in court by have multiple court during the week would help speeding the court systems up a little bit faster. So thank you.
Gerald.
I'm there every day of the week. We have pre-warrant hearings on Tuesday. We have small claims cases on Wednesday, landlord-tenant disputes on Thursday morning, deposit account fraud and county ordinances on Thursday afternoon. We also have committal hearings on Friday. So we've got it spread out, so we're trying to accommodate everybody to get you in there and get you served with whatever case that you need to have heard. But I also want to respond real quickly to what was said. Everything done in magistrate court is open to the public. You can walk into the courtroom and sit down and observe any hearing. And with that said, you know, as far as the teleconferencing, it's saving the city money, it's saving the county money, it's making us more available to law enforcement in addition to be and exigent circumstance matters, but in addition to being available Monday through Friday, I'm on call at night, on the weekends, on holidays, and 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So if I can make it more efficient than what I'm doing, that's my goal, and I'll keep considering those things to try to make that the best for you because I'm your servant.
Okay. Thank you very much. Closing statement, Savannah.
Well, what you say is true about an open court, but not serving the warrant. That's just private matters. I don't think you can recognize that court is always open court. So that being said, I want to appreciate the Habersham County citizens who give me the opportunity to serve. I have been serving now, but I want to continue to serve in a higher capacity. So if you vote for Suwan Sumo Toilet, you vote for the veteran. Thank you.
Okay, Gerald.
I want to say thank you, Senator. I want to also say thank you to Farm Bureau, the Chamber, and all of you folks that have given me this amazing opportunity to serve you as your chief magistrate. I've been blessed with so many opportunities in my career, and I'm very happy to be in the position I am. I don't think I'm anything special because I'm the chief magistrate, but what I am is a public servant, and I have always been a public servant. As far as the oath to defend the Constitution of the United States, I admire my partner here for being a Navy veteran and any other veteran. Can't say anything but great things about his service in that capacity. But I, too, took an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States and the state of Georgia and law enforcement, and I share those same values that have been articulated here tonight. I'm just glad to be in this position and hope that I can continue to serve you for the next 4 years in this capacity. I want to, most importantly, whoever you vote for, I want you to remember to pray for all of us, but I also need your support and your vote coming up for Chief Magistrate.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen. Okay, next we have the candidates for Sheriff, running for Habersham County Sheriff. We have incumbent Joy Terrell, Tanya Elrod, and Chad Miller. We'll begin with you, Joey, with your opening remarks.
Thank you, Senator. You know, it's been an honor and a privilege to serve you as sheriff for the last 7.5 years. God has been good to us. He spared us many things, both in work and personally. We have strived to make our office better. We've implemented many programs and changes. We started Citizens Law Enforcement Academy trying to get you, the citizens, involved in what does law enforcement do? Why do we do it? Why does the courts do what they do? We have, you know, started on training division because in today's world, you're judged by what you do. And so we want the best trained officers that we can have on the streets. Our guys do an excellent job, and they strive to serve the citizens of Habersham County. And I thank you for allowing me to be your sheriff for the last 7 years.
Okay, Joy, thank you. Tanya Elrod.
Yes, sir. First, I'd like to thank everyone for coming from Farm Bureau and you and everyone that come, taking time out of your busy schedule. I appreciate that, to come hear what we have to say. My name is Tanya Elrod. I grew up in this county. I've lived here for 43 years. I went to college, and after graduating college, instead of using my teaching degree, I went where I thought I would serve best, and that's the sheriff's office. It's where my heart falls. I love the county, I love the community, and I love to get out and help and serve people. That's where I've been for the last 18 years. I've been doing that, and I enjoy it, and there's nothing else that I can possibly think of in this world that I would rather do than come and serve you and be here to help you and make this county better than what it ever could be. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Chad Miller.
Yes, Senator, thank you. I'd like to thank Farm Bureau and North Georgia Tech for putting this on. I am Chad Miller. I worked at Hall County Sheriff's Department for the last 25 years. I've been in, been on patrol, been in special ops, been in investigations, been in several areas down there. And being out of the county for that long, I never left. I grew up here, graduated in 1985 from Habersham Central. There again, we live in the North End, me and my wife, two kids, and we wound up, or I did, I wound up driving back and forth all these years, so that kind of left me out of the loop from knowing a lot of people that's moved in over the 25 years. I've had the question asked to me, who is Chad Miller? Well, here I am. I've got out, I've went and walked door to door, I've been to most businesses within Habersham to get my name out there, and that's what I've done so far. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, first question. Joy, we'll start with you. How would you assure that child molesters would be investigated in such a manner that they would be removed from society in order to protect our children?
Well, when we were first elected, we started, we had an investigator that does nothing but child molestation investigations. We worked with the county commission on how can we make this better. I say that because me and Sonny were called before a special grand jury on what are you going to do. We worked with the Circle of Hope, and we acquired a grant through the, it's a VOCA grant, it's the same grant that they're funding under. And we have two investigators that work full-time doing crimes against persons, child molestations, child abuse. They're at the Powerhouse for Kids almost every day, looking at interviewing folks, looking to make cases better, because if we have to do a good investigation, so we work with the DA's office to get a good prosecution through our court system. So we work as a team together to get the prosecution so these individuals can be put in jail and stay in jail.
Okay. Tanya, you want to respond to that question?
I will. Like Joey said, and I do agree, it's going to be teamwork. It's going to take all of us getting together, getting into our court systems with our district attorneys, and going as high as we possibly can to protect our children. This is a huge problem. It's a lot bigger than a lot of people do realize. But again, it's going to take the teamwork. There's grants out there. There's opportunities for us to get involved, get more people involved, grants to get more officers to put on that certain subject in order to protect our children.
Okay, thank you. Chad?
That's going to take some work with the courts. It's going to take some training. An officer that's out there that don't have the appropriate training on some subject as that is going to let this thing fall through the cracks, and that's something that it can't. There's just no way. Especially children involved. You know, this is something that when you get an officer and you hire him, he goes through patrol, he winds up in investigations, he's got to want that. That's got to be in his heart. That type of person with the right training, dealing with courts and watching your budget on something of that nature is the only way to tackle that problem.
Okay. Thank you, Chad. Okay, we're going to give you the first question, our next question, Chad. What is your position on consolidation of services so that we can reduce or remove overlapping services and save taxpayers money? I would assume the question is referring to law enforcement in some way.
Well, and I'm kind of losing you on the overlapping of services there.
I don't know. I'm question.
You know, written. To as far as any budget or anything that's overlapping within the department, you've got to sit here, you've got to work with the county manager, the county commissioners. You have to look with in the department to see things that need to be fixed, things that you're going to have to look at. If it all boils down to money, you've got to work with these other agencies. These other people that's working around you to make sure that you keep that budget where it needs to be.
Okay. Tanya?
Sir, yes, it is going to take everyone working together. Not just one person can get in and do that. It's something that you're going to have to go to other agencies. You got to get with your commissioners, someone that handle your money. You know, that's what they do best. You get in there and you work together, you crunch those numbers, you make sure you have people where they need to be, and you try to cut down on that budget, but law enforcement, it's hard. You need those people out there to go on the streets and to have those other agencies with you. Like I said, it's a hard thing. It's something you can sit down and look at with each other, go over it with your commissioners, and make sure that everything's where it needs to be.
Joey?
We've talked with cities before on doing some consolidation of services. What we're talking about is basically doing away with the police department and the sheriff's office taking it over. But lots of times it's a loss of identity. Those municipalities don't want to lose their identity as a city. They lose their police department, lose their fire department, they lose their identity of who they are. And that's the last thing we want, is for one of our municipalities to lose an identity. Because there's 7 unique cities inside our county. That's what makes us so great. And we don't want that. I don't want that as a leader in our county. We don't want them to lose their identity. But we do want to look at helping one another. We look at partnering in a training center. If it wasn't for our municipalities helping the county sometimes cover calls in the county, we would have to have more officers in the county to cover calls. So we work together as a unit as it is now. But the cities, if they want to do with their police, it's up to the citizens of that city that says, we don't want our own police department, we want it covered by the sheriff's office.
Okay, next question. And we'll start back with you, Joey. What is your plan to limit or remove the proliferation of drug production, sales, and use in our county? Any thoughts?
Well, you know, I wish I could sit here and say, we're doing away with drugs. I promise you, no more drugs. It's not going to happen. Somebody up here earlier was talking about supply and demand. There's such a great supply of drugs that's flooding into our country that it's unreal. Atlanta is the hub for drug activity in our nation, the hub. More drugs come into Atlanta than any other place in our nation. And that's just down the street, folks. That's right below us. We work hard with other agencies. We're looking to add another drug enforcement agent to the Appalachian Drug Task Force, so we'll have two work in our county. But it's more than just drug enforcement. You have to look on the other side of it. You have to look at drug education. We've got officers in the schools trying to educate the children. We work with drug court. Our chaplains in the jail work with those who are addicted to drugs to try and get them off of it. Only through that way are we going to stem the flow of drugs, is to stop the help stop the folks who's on it, to get them off of drugs.
Okay, thank you. Tanya?
Like Joe's saying, I feel like I kind of repeat them, but it all boils down to the same concept. It takes the officers out there to go to the calls, to beat the streets, to pull the cars over, to find where these drugs are coming from. Unfortunately, they're coming from everywhere around. Like he said, Atlanta is the absolute capital of where it's coming. It's all coming up through here. Education, it's going to be educating our officers. It's going to be educating our communities, our schools. We need more resources and ways to get into the schools to teach our children about these drugs, because they're starting out at such an early age now that it is unreal. I mean, you have people that, unfortunately, I fortunately grew up in a great home. My parents were the most supportive ever, and never would have thought them to ask me to do anything wrong. Good Christian people. You do have parents now, though, that will put drugs in their kids' school bags to send to other kids, not knowing. It's an education thing. It's getting together with agencies. It's getting more people to be able to get that done and took care of.
Okay. Chad?
Training, outside resources, community involvement. To me, that's three things that this is what it's going to take to at least help. And I agree with both of these. They hit the nail on the head. I mean, the schools, you know, the school teachers, I mean, even your clerks within the county. I've had them, you know, I've pulled up there to walk in to get a coat, and I've had them say, hey, you've got three people come in here, went in the bathroom, went up, put it in the ceiling, or stand on the toilet. You go up there and you find it, there it is. I mean, it's out here everywhere, but how are you gonna slow it down? You're not gonna stop it, but how are you gonna slow it down is utilize the resources of your federal agencies, state agencies. There again, your training of your own guys that you've got, if they can get all the training they can get, come back and put it to use, and community involvement. You people, y'all can talk and help. Thank you.
Okay, Chad, we're going to start with you on the next question. If elected, do you plan to utilize no-knock warrants? And please explain why, whether your answer is yes or no.
No. No-knock warrants. We've seen it get us into trouble in Atlanta. We've seen it get us into trouble up here. A no-knock warrant, and I'm not gonna get into certain situations, by no means. I've been on a couple of them myself. They could have went bad. But reverting from a no-knock warrant to where it can go bad, there's other means that you can go in there safely for both the agency and the home occupant. And I know I said no pretty quick, but guys, I'm going to tell you, it don't take long for that to go bad, and it don't take long for the finger to get pointed at you. And that's something that, just to be honest with you, why can you not take a battering ram, swap over to it, knock a door in, you're just pushing the door aside and walking on in. It's enough.
Okay. Tanya?
Sir. No, the way the world is today, you put too many people at stake. You have no idea sometimes who's in those house. You have your officers that want to go home. You have people at home wanting your families to come home. There's too many people today have guns. You never know what's waiting on the other side of that door. It's something I believe you can sit and wait out. You can use other resources to do. Like Chad, I've been on no-knock warrants. They're scary. They are, because you don't know exactly what's going to be waiting. You don't know if you're going to go home that night. All kind of things go through your head. Like I say, there's too many innocent people out that are unfortunately involved in some of these things. People bring them in, bring it in their home. Some parents don't even know. Some children don't know. So, no, I believe there's other ways. There's safer ways to do it.
without putting everybody at risk.
Okay, Joy.
You know, sitting here thinking about this question, you think about the things that's happened to us. Think about where we've been, what we've been through, not only as a department, but as a county. Do we ever want anything like to have that to happen again? No. But can I sit here and tell you that we will never, ever use a no-knock warrant again? I don't know that I can do that. But is the process different on how you do it? Absolutely. Do you look at things a whole lot tighter when you do it? Absolutely. We don't take the violation of people's constitutional rights lightly. That's what we do every day. We're constitutional officers. That's what we do. We don't take that lightly whatsoever. But do we go ask for no-knock search warrants anymore? No, we don't do that anymore. But I can't honestly tell you that we will never, ever ask for one. I can't sit here and tell you that we will ever do that. I'm not going to lie to you.
Okay. Next question, and Joey, we'll start with you on this one. Will you name a specific area in which you can or will improve the performance of the Sheriff's Department? And what will it cost? Any thoughts?
Cost. There's a big word. What's it going to cost? We're always looking to improve. How do we improve? And one of the biggest ways is how we serve our citizens. How do we interact with our citizens? How does our deputies interact with our citizens? That's citizen encounters, it's called when you go through the police academy, using the air quotes right there. That's what they teach. Your citizens encounter. What do you do? That's the biggest thing that we can improve on. You know, we fail at that all the time. We do. We fail at that all the time because there's going to be an officer that says something cross to somebody that they shouldn't. Why do they do that? Because they're human. They're human like everybody else is human. We make mistakes. They argue with their wives. They fight about money. They argue about all kinds of things. And sometimes that translates into what we do. But working with our training, we strive really hard to impress on our officers what our interaction with our citizens are. That very first word you say to them is going to dictate what happens through the course of the interaction with them.
Will you name a specific area in which you can and will improve the performance of the Sheriff's Department, and what will it cost?
Cost, like Joey said, you can't put a number on some things. Training is my big thing. That's where it all starts and that's where it all ends. You've got to train constantly. On the job, you're training 24/7. I mean, from the morning you start or the evening you start on at work, you're training. You're not just there answering calls, you're training. You're teaching yourself, you're teaching everyone else that you work with. So to put a cost on it, no, I can't. But okay. What it all boils down to is in-depth training.
Okay, Chad.
I'm going to say there's about three things there. There's community involvement, there's training, and there's staffing. You know, can you put a cost on it? No. I agree with the other two, but you can watch it. You know, then there has to be a cap there somewhere putting it on there. And that comes with discussion of, you know, your command staff. It comes to discussion with the community. There's several of y'all that's in here. There's several that's been out through the last three or four weeks that's come up to me and they've talked to me. And they give good ideas. You guys give great ideas. It can be used in the Sheriff's Department. So, you know, but going back to this cost thing, you know, that's always first and foremost on everybody's mind, and I definitely agree. But you when you say you can't put a cost on it, you've got to keep in mind you got to put a cap somewhere. You got to keep an eye on it.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think we got all three on that question.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Final question. We'll start with you, Chad, coming back in this direction. Okay. Since most illegal drugs are confiscated from commercial vehicles, how would you implement the coordination of the Motor Carrier Division, commonly known as DOT, as they do not have to have probable cause to stop and inspect any commercial vehicle?
I'd give them a ring and say, let's go at it. I mean, to confiscate these illegal drugs using DMVS, there again, like we talked earlier, that's going to be one of the agencies, let alone two or three more that's involved, to get out here and work it. It just takes, it takes time. It takes knowledge. It takes training. It takes experience from these officers to get out here and work it. That's one thing you're going to hear officers talk about a lot, knowledge, training, and experience. And, you know, you got the three of us sitting up here, we got a lot. But, you know, as far as the question at hand, that's just something that with the DMVS and getting out here working is one tool that is excellent to have when you're working that type of crime.
Okay. Tanya?
Sir, like you said, it's going to be getting with those agencies, being able to work with them, call them, knowing that you can utilize them, they can use you, get out there, you know, fight it as hard as you can with the people that you have. I say basically it's just getting with your different agencies, being able to work with them, work together to make everything better.
Okay. Joy?
Motor Carrier Compliance Division is like every other agency, strapped for personnel. We have worked with them in the past on stopping trucks, looking for illegal cargo, not only drugs, we found other illegal cargo. They are doing an initiative to add more officers to help with the policing of the trucks on the road. And hopefully that's gonna add more officers to our area, working the 365 corridor, Georgia 15 corridor as it runs to Tocoa and then over up to North Carolina, because it's a pipeline. It's a pipeline for drugs going to Western North Carolina, Eastern Tennessee. We get tips, use that word loosely, from the DEA about trucks bringing drugs through. But if you've ever worked drugs, you have to work on doper time. And doper time takes time. So you have to have officers that go out and sit and just wait, and you have to wait, and you have to wait on them. So that eats up the thing we talked about, costs. We talk about budgets. We talk about overtime. So that's the backside of talking about all this.
Okay, time for closing statements. And, Chad, we're going to start on your end this time, closing.
Thank you. As far as this election goes, I'm going to tell you, do your homework. And when I say that, you know, every candidate in here and the other two that's sitting here, do your homework. Go up and talk to them. Go in here and find out what they're about. I've always told somebody, don't ask me if you want to know about me. I'll tell you. Talk to my friends. Talk to people that know me. You know, some of them might tell you one thing, might tell you another. But the three things that my platform I'm running on is community involvement. I want to know. I want to know what everybody's got to say. Training for specific officers. This officer wants to go to investigations and you've got him in traffic, he might make you a good officer. You put him there instead of giving him a whole lot of classes and wasting money in traffic. He winds up in investigations. Put your money there. He's going to be there. He's going to stay. And staffing. And I'll ask for your vote. Come May the 2nd or May the 24th.
Okay, Tanya.
Sir, again, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out to hear what we have to say. Again, I've been here for 18 years, and the reason that I stay in law enforcement is because I love the county. I love the community. I love getting involved, and I love to help people. That's my biggest thing. And what I've learned throughout this campaign is, first off, it's nerve-wracking. I mean, I had no idea the things that would go in. But what I will say is I want to thank Chad and I want to thank Joey, because I know that I could pick the phone up and call either one of them throughout this time. We have been here to help each other. We have not bashed each other, not one time. I sit beside two men I do highly respect. We all have our differences of opinions and the different ways that we can run the county. But like Chad said, educate yourself. Come talk to us. I know all three of us are here at any point in time you would like to. I'll answer any questions you have, and I'll be here to help you in any way that I can. And I appreciate you again, and I appreciate your vote on this upcoming election on the 24th. Thank you.
Okay. Joy?
An old gentleman by the name of Hoyt Adair told me one time, you take office on January 1st and you start running for re-election on January 2nd. We've tried to do that, being involved in our community, going sitting in a dunk tank. I'm going to dress up as a woman for the Circle of Hope here in a few days in a womanless beauty pageant. Please come vote for me. I need your vote on that one, too. We try and stay involved in our community. I love my community. My children go to school here. We have a partnership with our school system. You know, we appreciate everything they do. They work hard. You know, God has been so good to us. He's blessed us so much. You know, I don't deserve to sit in this chair. I don't deserve to do the job, but he has been so good to us. And I appreciate that so much. Early voting starts May 2nd, runs through the week before voting on the 24th, but it starts the 16th at the Aquatic Center, and then May 24th is the day. If you don't want to vote for me, which I ask you to please vote for me, but you got to get out and vote, folks. Vote your heart. Vote your conscience.
Thank you, Jerry. Next, we're going to hear from the state court judge candidates. We have Stephen Campbell and Rob Kiker. Okay, Steve, with your opening statement.
Good evening. I'm Steve Campbell. I'm your state court judge. I've been the state court judge since September of 2010 when Governor Perdue appointed me to this position. I was reelected without opposition in 2012, and I'm up for reelection this year. Couple of quick things. I live in Cornelia. I have a practice. I'm a state court is a part-time court. I have a law practice in Cornelia. I serve as a city attorney in Cornelia. I have been a lawyer in Habersham County since 1990, then really at the end of 1991. Practice with my wife, Susan. We have Campbell and Campbell as our law firm. We have a daughter, Sarah. She's everything to us. Few things you need to know. State court handles jury trials and bench trials for criminal misdemeanor cases and for civil cases, and like damages cases. We still have a lot of collection cases in state court. I've been in state court as either the prosecutor or the judge since 1993. I have a lot of experience in the court. I think our court's very efficient. I think it's run with integrity. I think it's run fairly. And I think the people who come to my court know very much that I care about getting the right answer, to trying to make sure that people don't come back when it's a criminal case, to make sure that people get a fair hearing when it's a hearing, and when they get a trial, they get a fair jury trial.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Rob.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you to Farm Bureau and to the Chamber for having this event. Great opportunity to come out and see the folks and let the folks look at your candidates. Steve and I have, or Mr. Campbell, and I have a parallel law practice or career. I think this is both our 29th year of practice. So we are both far technically qualified to serve as state court judge. Both of us have extensive experience in civil and criminal litigation. But when you elect a judge, what you look for is the person that goes to the bench. You look for the characteristics: judgment, temperament, respect. And those are reflected both in the way that you manage your court, how you treat the people who come before you, and how you manage the assets entrusted to you by the taxpayers.
Okay, thank you very much. So now we'll get on with the questions. Question number one, and we'll start with you, Steve. Should a judge be held to a higher standard of personal conduct? And if so, what have you personally done to uphold this standard?
I do think a judge should be held to a higher standard. The court is always paramount for a person who holds that position. You must follow the law. You must follow your heart. But you must hold yourself out and make good decisions, make the kind of choices that reflect positively not only upon yourself, but also upon the court. It's an essential part of being a judge. You know, we've had different situations with judges in this state over the last few years, and I think it's critical that when you consider this position, that you look at character, that you look at how the person holds himself out and how they operate their lives. I think it's a very essential thing. And I don't know how this court system can survive if those particular stellar traits of character are not a part of what you consider when electing a judge.
Okay, Rob, you want to react to that?
Oh, I agree wholeheartedly. What you have to do is hold yourself to a high standard. And you hold yourself to a high standard in the way that you conduct your personal life, of course, but also how you conduct your court, how you treat people who come before you. Because the people in this county, if you are going to appear in a court, particularly in a criminal matter, it is most likely to be in the state court. And you need to be treated with respect and dignity and with the highest of standards. A judge is charged not only with a lack of impropriety, but an appearance of a lack of impropriety. And that's true personally and professionally.
Okay, Rob, next question. Since current laws may not properly address the current trend with teens of sex texting, I presume that's the way that's to be pronounced, how will you handle these cases brought to you?
Well, first, you do have to look to the law. And if it's a misdemeanor case or a felony, of course, state court is limited to misdemeanor cases. The sex texting laws are still in development. They're still being worked because of the new technology, because of the new challenges here. You know, we're seeing things with the change in the internet and communications we've never experienced before. For instance, some discovery nowadays you can do via internet versus via paperwork. You can file things online versus the old-fashioned filings. So part of it, though, we have to look to the parents. You know, you need to stay in touch with your children. You need to make sure that you know what they're doing on their cell phone, because if you look around, and I've gone across this county, and you see people sitting, in especially children, with a cell phone in front of them, and they need, so time's up.
Steve?
We haven't seen a lot of sexting cases yet in state court. I really couldn't tell you that I can recall seeing one at this point. I suspect as the law develops and as enforcement of that law becomes more, happens more often, we'll see a lot more of it. A lot of times, of course, we're dealing with juvenile court cases. If it would be somebody under 16 or under, when you're 17, you get to state court. And I would suspect that, as always, the goal would be to find a way to make sure that whoever commits that offense, it doesn't come back. I want to address something really quickly. I put it to everybody here that every person who comes in my court, and you can ask every lawyer on this row, every lawyer in this courtroom, I guess with the exception of my opponent, that every person who comes to my court is treated with the utmost dignity and respect. I treat people, I make sure that they understand what's going on. It's the most important and essential thing I do in my courtroom, and you can ask anybody who actively practices in my court that that's not the case. I promise you that I've been upholding the law in the State Court of Habersham County for a long time, and it will continue, and I completely reject any idea that that's not being done today, and will continue as we go forward.
Thank you, Steve. Illegal drugs and abuse of prescription drugs are a tremendous problem in Habersham County. What is your plan to assist these individuals and our community with this problem? Steve, you want to start this one?
No, one more time, sorry.
Illegal drugs and abuse of prescription drugs are a tremendous problem in Habersham County. What is your plan to assist these individuals and our community with this problem?
It is the most serious problem you can imagine. I continually see people who are suffering from, whether it's through drug abuse or mental health issues. Really, the development of our accountability courts going forward would be one way in particular to try to identify those persons and give them the opportunity to fix or to remedy those problems. It is something which has increased over the years. I see it routinely now, and I just hope that as the county grows, one of the things I know that we start to get more access to funding to make sure that we have access to the programs we need to identify individual issues and try to help them not come back. It's just a continual issue.
Problem.
I don't think funding is a problem. I think this court is well funded. One thing that I have done, I've actually explored this issue because drugs, that is a major problem for our future and our children. And it is a problem faced by all the courts. I went to Stevens County to look at their probation program. Now, they have decided to take their probation program back into the public probation rather than farming it out privately. And what that does is that gives a judge more opportunity and more discretion in sentencing, having pretrial diversions, because oftentimes, if someone does make a mistake, a child, a teenager, someone, say, younger, and they have a problem and are sentenced as a drug offender, then it puts them on a path and down a road that is hard to get off of. Because what's happening is you're limiting their ability for certain positions, for work, for opportunities. And I think that I would like to give them another opportunity to avoid that path.
Okay, Rob, we'll start with you with this next question. Are all state court employees housed at the courthouse? If not, why not?
Well, they are not housed at the courthouse. There's been this statement about they're doing the things as they have always been done. Well, this is the 21st century, and it's time to make some changes. We have a judicial center that was built and completed in 2013 that included offices for all of the courts, including the state court. And in 2014, Judge Campbell asked for and received a full-time county paid employee secretary. And that secretary is not located in the state court offices. If elected judge, I would bring that secretary into the courthouse, open the offices to make it a more fully functional court as the other courts are. Because if you go to any other court, you will see the staffing, you will see the people there. You can go to the master court. We have, of course, opposition there, probate court. State court, you don't have that situation. Now, it's been said it is a part-time judgeship. It's part-time from the standpoint that the judge is not paid full-time, but the court is fully funded for full-time.
All right.
Steve.
So in 2014, I didn't ask for anything. The secretarial position for the state court continues to operate as it did prior to my becoming judge. And while there was, from my perspective, it's continued to operate exactly the same way since the time I became judge in 2010. Let me just say a couple of things. State court is a part-time court. Let me ask you a question. Do you think it would be a good idea for a part-time judge and a part-time and possibly a full-time lawyer to take up space in the courthouse, holding himself out as a judge while having the ability to practice law? Do you think that could be subject to some abuse? Do you think that that would be a good idea for Habersham County, for example, for me to go over there tomorrow and start hanging out in the courthouse with the ability to practice private law all the time, like Mr. Kiker is thinking is a good idea? I put it to you that that is the worst thing possible. Come to the judge, come to the lawyer's office. He's the judge in the courthouse. That's a great idea. I recommend that I'm being completely facetious there. I'm just telling you that's a horrible idea. As long as I'm a part-time lawyer and a part-time judge, I'm going to be in private practice and then come to the courthouse when it's time for me to be the judge. That's the important thing.
Okay, final question. Steve, are each of your each of you current with all of your state and federal tax returns?
I am completely current with all my federal and state tax returns. I have never missed a return. I have filed the tax return in every year since I've been an adult. I have filed and I continue to completely adhere to every law. I ask anybody to scrutinize my record in any way, shape, or form they want to regarding my payment of any taxes. And I'm just telling you, I've been a public servant since 1993, and I guarantee you that I have lived my life and operated my personal and private business with the utmost idea of trying to make sure I live something I can be proud of, and that my wife can be proud of, and that my daughter can be proud of. That's it.
Rob?
Yes, sir. Any and all tax returns that are due where I would owe any taxes, I don't have any outstanding tax returns of that case, except this year. I don't have a tax return filed this year yet. So.
Okay. Final closing statements. We'll start with you, Rob.
Much has been said about integrity, about trusting your judge. Now, I made a statement here and Mr. Campbell rebuked it. I have to tell you that there is a letter to the personnel file of the Habersham County Commissioner's Office where there was an administrative assistant that was asked to be able to work 40 hours a week with an annual salary of $25,251.20 together with all benefits to a full-time employee. That was on 27 February 2014. That was a change in the court. That was a change in the personnel situation. That was a change in the budget. And that letter was signed by Steve Campbell as judge of state court. I want to tell you, it's been an honor and a privilege to work and run for this position. And I'm humbled by the support. I think it's hard not to see who the supporters are, and I want to tell you, I have a hard time saying things about myself. I don't like that, but if you want to know why to vote for me, well, I think you can pick them out there. They're proudly wearing my name, and I'm humbled by that and appreciate it.
Okay, thank you, Rob. All right, Steve, your final thoughts.
All right, so the letter that he just referred to that he just put back underneath his pad that he doesn't want, I guess, me to see, let me tell you what that really says, and here's what it says. It says that she'll work a 40-hour work week. There's not a word about full-time in here, and she'll pay an annual salary of $25,251.20. Here's a letter from the county manager dated today, Mr. Kiker. Judge Campbell, the state court judge's secretary is a salaried position exempt from the Fair Labor Standards Act. Therefore, hourly wage rates do not apply. The county understands that the judge's secretary works out of the private law office of the judge and receives a separate salary for her private law firm work as well. The county has no objection to this practice, which is the same as that for the solicitor's office and the judge's predecessors in office. I wish to clarify and correct the spreadsheet, which I can go on and on about this thing at some level, but you've heard the real issue. That letter, yes, I did it, and there absolutely that happened, but the practice never changed, and the county knew it. We've been doing it the same way forever, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with the way state court operates. It is completely ethical. It is completely, you can account for every dollar, and for somebody to sit here who's been in my court three times in 25 years to tell me that we're running it unethically is just a bunch of junk.
Okay. That concludes our programming.